quay cho. Ông chúng mình nhiều đây, các cam to, các chấm nạc để chế vị thị sản nạc. Một nâng phát đoàn vị thị ca từ cổ mệnh vị ca bị cất đấy, ông nhầm đây, xong chấm riêp, ông bị sự đầy dầm rách. Rồi bỏ ông nhầm đây. Từ lưu ca cài prai cao bị phía xâm rạp phư sản nạc ca, xâm rạp sạp đạc rồi. Đời cổ mệnh vị bàn sát đập nơi xâm nạc xong, rồi bỏ cổ mệnh vị ca bị cất đấy nôn chia. Hay nâng sẽ đáp nơi mặt tệ dự bò vì cổng phía kỳ này đường cái đây là tây tiết ông nhầm rẻ bàn về phía xa khai hay xâm rạch còn nót cao về phía xâm rạp thư xạm đà cá xâm rạp xạm đà cao đi khăn cao đi nơi bước ngày chắn xua chân chọc cháu nguồn chi nơi đồ xíl ông nhầm rẻ nâng mần thư xạm đà cá tì ngay ông kia sẽ đáp ra khai cắm xã xây đôi bình mùi tháng ngày tiền bực tiền là nghiệp bực ngày put xua chun chọp chào nôn chia nơi rô xíl mình thư xạm nà ca tì nơi tháng ngày bởi hoa xua bắt đó ở đây rạp khai cắm rồi bỏ xã xây căng kỳ yêu hạ đôi bình mùi tháng ngày tiền bực tiền là nghiệp hay ông chủ đề có thông chủ đề chun phong này thà cao bị phía sạm nà ca ní miền lệ cái nạ bọt bén hay sầm rập tại cái sạm nà ca sầm rập sạm đà cày mình nô mình men chi cả sầm rập ăn vót được pil khang mục tiệt ti hay bảy hà mùi tiết ông chủ đề xong đòi phía kỳ này đường cái đây thà khăn ông cả này luôn bàn cọt thùng quan khơi thà miền bảy hà rồi điên khnì rồi cái đôi khnì ní nơi bề cầu như sông Phật Đà Bồ Đề Miên rồi còn phương tâm nào sông ở bản chấp mà ông nhầm ra từ là từ bốn đồng bây ông nhầm ra miên là tập hiệp đã bị phía xa rồi bị cha ra na sầm rách điệp châm được cao bị phía sạm na cá ở phương giang na ở bậc Phật tử bản chấp rồi ha nâng miên bậc sự tập hiệp bản hạ tỷ pí cứ nơi được xin đi tâm đồng chi ai trời bình diệp bên sạm na cá mà phải cho sam tâm đệ tì đời xa tam kệ cao bị phía dương khinh tha nơi phía kỳ này đường cái đây กรมมีตบีกาเปียกได้เมียนไปเรียมวยมองสามสิบนาทีให้ปัญหาในวิอัตรายจะเลือกการเลือกล้างการระบบเพื่อกี้เวรดิคลายปนนอแต่ตัวใบยังนากระได้อย่างยิ่งได้ส่งยิ่งเรียบท่าปัญหานี้ยังขยมบานสำหรับรั่วยิ่งมวยนังคางองกับเพียบดักติงจุนในอบตโกได้ให้ดังไปเรียบจำสำรั่วในการทุ่มตำนานตลอดตัววิ่งจะบอกพิกี้ให้นางบุญไตรบอกกระลึกได้จะบอกอวตโกปัญหามุ่ยเทียดคือดำใบปัจจัยบันแต่ฉบับล้อไทม์เทียดโดยจะมีการกอดถมก้อนหรือปัญหามุ่ยจมนวลในขนมกาปลาปิปิงในขนมกาจำนาการนี่อาจจะทุ่มมีการพอนจะล้อมยังเข้มสมบุกุลเพริยจุนเตยลุสไรจะกร้อมดำใบจมเรียบจุนตะพิกี้สมใจลุสไรจะกร้อม
Thank you, President.
The
trial chamber has a further comment to make on another matter. The co-prosecutors and the defence team for Nguyen Chia have raised the use of the term mini-trial during case 002. The trial chamber agrees with the prosecutors that the use of the term is inappropriate in a courtroom where precise, appropriate and unemotional language is of great importance to all parties and for the dignity of the proceedings. The term is inaccurate if it implies an assessment of the length of case 002/001. It also suggests inaccurately that the charges against the accused and the impact of the alleged crimes on the victims are not serious. That is the comment that the trial chamber wishes to make on this topic. Thank you, President.
អរគុណលោកត្រីចក្រមជាបន្តនេះអង្គជំរះសូមផ្ដល់វេទិកាជូនទៅក្រុមវេទិកាពាក្យក្តីទាំង3ក្រុមដើម្បីមានឱកាសនៅក្នុងការលើកឡើងទៅនឹងការជំទាស់នឹងការស្ដាប់ទៅខៃកម្មរបស់អ្នកជំនាញប៊ិនខេនិនតាមរយៈប្រព័ន្ធសោទស្សន៍ហើយនឹងលើកតាក់ហៃកោសូមឯកសារបន្ថែមពីអ្នកជំនាញប៊ិនខេនិនឲ្យបានមុនពេលគាត់មកដល់ទៅខៃកម្ម ហើយអង្គជំរះសូមជម្រាបថាក្រុមមេធាវីទាំង3ក្រុមគឺមានពេល1ម៉ោងកន្លះហើយការបែងចែកពេលវេលាអាស្រ័យទៅលើក្រុមមេធាវីទាំង3ក្រុមក្នុងករណីមិនមានការបែងចែកពេលវេលាទេនោះគឺមួយក្រុមមានពេលវេលា30នាទីហើយដែលឡែកដោយសារបញ្ហានេះជាការលើកឡើងដោយក្រុមមេធាវីការពារក្តីអៀងសេរីដូច្នេះអង្គជំរះសូមផ្ដល់ជូន
Thank you, Mr. President. Thank you, Your Honors. And good afternoon to everyone in and around the courtroom. I have spoken with my colleagues. I will be using up the lion's share of the time, though I do believe that we may be able to finish as usually around 4 o'clock. I will try to be as efficient as possible. With that, I should note that a few moments ago I was provided with the material, the exchanges between the prosecution and Mr. Kiernan, and I regret if I will be, if I'm going to be less than articulate or eloquent in my presentation due to not having sufficient time to look over this material. So if I'm less than eloquent in my arguments, that is one of the reasons. But let's see how it goes. First, Your Honors, let me address the last point, that is the point concerning our request for additional information. I could deal with that in about 5 minutes or less. In preparation for Professor Kiernan, and as was noted earlier, he has written extensively, and as we consulted others who are equally knowledgeable about that period of time and the events, it dawned on us that was that there may be additional information that we would need. Some of the material that we requested, we only learned of, or heard about, I should say, at about the time that we made the request. It was, to be honest, with the trial chamber, an afterthought as we were asking for this, to also ask for notes and what have you, in part because in reviewing his books, it is very clear that often statements are made, or assertions are made, or conclusions are drawn, and no witnesses are cited, no authority is cited. So it was for that reason. Handwritten notes. Well, the prosecution has argued that at least one of the journalists that's scheduled to be here and testify kept notes. And in fact, those notes are on the case file. We made a request. We believed it was an honest request. And we left it up to Your Honors to decide once when we get anything from Mr. Kiernan as to what any of it might be relevant to use in court. What shocks us is the prosecution's attitude, shared by, well, I should say, echoed, because no matter what the prosecution says, the civil parties argue, so they're actually one party as far as we know, that there was this immediate visceral reaction. And they begin to make excuses for Dr. Kiernan when they haven't even bothered to ask him. And we suggest, Your Honors, that there is no harm in asking Dr. Kiernan, for instance, with the academic articles, if he has copies of them, and would he be willing to share them? Can the court force him to turn it over? Of course not. Are we asking the court to force him? No, but we made a request so that request could be passed on to Dr. Kiernan to see whether he would be willing to share this information with us so we could be better prepared for our examination of him. Is it late in the day? Well, it would appear to be rather late in the day. We can see that, but when you consider all that there is in this case file and all the reading that we have been doing, and now that we are at the trial stage, in addition to all the legal issues that we had to deal with, it is not until you begin really preparing for a witness and actually going through all the material and focusing on the witness that things appear and ideas begin to shape. And it's at that time that you may find that perhaps you may need some additional information. I come from a jurisdiction where it doesn't hurt to ask. Now, the trial chamber can simply say, I'm sorry, we're not going to bother to ask him, or you might decide that it may be worth to ask Dr. Kiernan. So I leave it to your discretion to determine what, if anything, from the list of material that we requested should be asked from Dr. Kiernan, whether he has it, and if so, whether he would be willing to share it. If the trial chamber deems the request outrageous, then you're free to say so. If you think that it's not necessary, you're free to say so as well. And whether we were diligent or not diligent, we do know and we do agree that the gentleman has written quite a bit and is considered one of the leading experts. So that's all I have to say with respect to that submission, Your Honors. So now let me focus on why Dr. Kiernan should not appear by video link, unless there are any questions from the bench concerning the first issue. Seeing no questions from the bench, now let me go into the issue about the video link. Over a month ago, Dr. Kiernan was contacted pursuant to the court's directions by Mr. Cayley, and there have been an exchange of not just emails but also, it appears, telephone conversations. And in one conversation, in fact, there were notations that were sent back to Dr. Kiernan, to sort of like minutes of a meeting, to make sure that there was an agreement as to what was said. So that is the material that I received today. And it appears that from the very beginning, at least from the very first exchange back in February, at face value, Mr. Cayley, in his letter to Professor Kiernan, this is on February 13th, notes that it is his understanding from the representative from the witness section that he's not available to come to Cambodia for 2012, but that he might be available to testify by video link in February, early March, and mid-April. Then in the fourth paragraph of this letter, he indicates, Mr. Cayley, that is, I think it might be helpful if we could talk by a video conference this week. So they have this conversation. And At some point, which is almost a month later, I believe it's March 8th, we finally get something from Professor Kiernan, where he notes the various activities or functions that he's carrying out. Now, had I had this information beforehand, I would have done my due diligence. I would have put somebody to go to Yale, someone from the United States or through the internet, to actually find out exactly how much of this is true, accurate, and complete. I don't take at face value anything that the gentleman says simply because his name is Kiernan. I wouldn't do that with any other witness. I won't do this with him. We do note, and we noted, we learned earlier from Google that he teaches a couple of classes. That's what's on the Yale website. The teaching schedule for the summer is already online, and Dr. Kiernan does not appear to have any teaching obligations during that period, though we do know that professors who are of this caliber have other general obligations in addition to publishing and supervising the committee work. So we do understand that he is busy. But what we do note that there's not a single date describing when these events are taking place and to why he is not available for the entire 2012. Now, had I been privy to have a conversation with Professor Kiernan, along with the prosecutor, I would have asked some specific dates. Can you please break it down? Tell us, what is when is spring break? What are you doing this summer? To break it down so we have some more idea. Merely what we have is a laundry list, and keep in mind that professors have students, they have assistants who teach for them and fill in their classes. Those who are doing their PhDs are not being supervised on a daily basis. They're normally told to go out, research, write, and come back, and you have a one-on-one on occasion, and they usually tend to be, at least in the United States, teaching assistants. And as far as committees go, one can absent themselves from a committee or participate by a video link from a foreign country. If it's necessary. And nowadays you can even do it by Skype on telephone at no cost. So from this, we don't see how it is that the gentleman is unavailable completely. Keep in mind that we were informed in October 2011 that the gentleman would be appearing in court. He's a prosecution witness, and I'm going to get to that. They say now he's a court witness, but really he's a prosecution witness. He is an advocate for the prosecution and for the civil parties. And the prosecution could not have but consulted with him during the investigative process before the matter was turned over to the OCIJ, either directly or indirectly. There are staff working in the prosecution's office that have had a long association, although albeit now bitter association or bitter relations with Dr. Kiernan. In fact, I'm speaking about Mr. Etchison, who used to be there at Yale and has worked with Dr. Kiernan, who's also worked with DC CAM. So to say now that he is an objective witness, or not even a witness, he's just some academic who's coming here and is going to be objective and therefore there's no need to worry about it, we say, no, that is not the case. He is a witness for the prosecution. And they may say there is no prejudice to the rights of the accused. Well, there's no prejudice to them, yes, because he is such an advocate. He can be an automatic and just answer any question and every question for them without any reticence. But when it comes to the defense, usually it's quite different, because at the defense side, he's going to be asked to provide authority for much of what he has written, or at least some of what he has written. We have identified approximately 50 topics, which the prosecution wishes to question this gentleman on at one point or another. Now, you may say, Your Honors, well, we've limited this case to only 002/01. Well, yes, you've limited. However, what has the prosecution done and it continues to do and will be able to do throughout this trial? They will say this is for contextual purposes, Your Honor. And then they stray into other areas. And so when you look at everything that they've asked this witness to testify on, they are not minor issues. It is every single topic, every significant issue that involves this case. And to merely say that he's an objective individual, that there's no prejudice, is simply nonsense. He's a terribly important witness, and that's why we insist that he come here. Going back to what I was saying earlier, he was contacted back in 2011, unless the prosecution put him on his list without even contacting him. They must have contacted him at some point to see whether he would be willing to testify or not. If not the prosecution, the trial chamber would have contacted him through one of your legal officers. Otherwise, why would you be notifying us back in October that he's on the list? Then you will note, Your Honors, and you will recall that in January, I asked whether Kiernan had been summoned. Now, I didn't ask it because I was just curious. Rumor has it that he's very reticent to come here. That is not that because he's got the schedule, but rather he does not want to come here and be confronted in person. And so we say at this point in time, with respect to who is Kiernan, he's a prosecution witness. He's a terribly important witness in this case, not just for the prosecution, but for us and for you, and for the civil parties, and therefore, he has to come. This knee-jerk reaction to say, gee, he's giving us a long list of activities, and now he's totally unavailable, but he may be available in 2013. Well, let me address that. If he may be available in 2013, he's got about 10 months or 9 months to get his calendar cleared up so he can identify when in 2013 he can come and give evidence. Now, you may say that evidence may be out of order. And I say you're professional judges. Usually, you would want your evidence to come in a particular narrative because the poor jury, the lay person, the non-professional judge may have difficulty in following the narrative of the evidence as it's coming in. But you're professional. And you know the case. And it matters not whether he testifies in 2012 or January or February 2013. And so to say, and for the prosecution to stand up and say, it's either 2012 by video link or nothing, that again is nonsense. And it's not midnight for Mr. Kiernan. There are other options. The question is he willing to come here, not whether he's able to come here. And I suggest is the former and not the latter. Let's look at some of the jurisprudence. Your Honors, today, we submitted an annex containing something in the neighborhood of 72 cases, 39 from the ICTY, 29 from the ICTR, 2 from the Special Court of Sierra Leone, and 2 from the ICC. This annex does not contain all of the cases. It's a representation of the cases. We've submitted, we've checked, and chosen the cases, and we're able to put this together on a very short notice. You have cases where they allowed video link and cases where video link was denied. So we try to be balanced. Now, coming from the defense, since we are a party, I'm making this as a disclaimer. It's coming from us. It doesn't have all the cases. We have a limited period of time. We did the best we could, and we looked at these various jurisdictions. And with that, let me add one other point. When it comes to the ICTY and ICTR, whenever you see a case, Your Honors, that it says the ICTR appeals court, we're talking about the ICTY appeals court. It is the same judges. So we're not talking about two different entities. When it comes to the trial chambers, that's different. But I think that we should not dismiss cases from the ICTR because they have been more stringent both at the trial level and at the appeal, but especially at the trial level, in making sure that witnesses actually appear. I'm told to slow down, and I will do so as ordered by my colleague. So, I will discuss just a few cases, but first, Your Honors, as you well know, that on 9 March 2012, we filed a written submission, and we titled them a response. We titled them a response because when we looked at what the prosecution filed as a notice, We saw that as a request. And in fact, Your Honors, have labeled this matter as having been seized with a request from the prosecution. Now, I don't want to go into whether they actually are the moving party or not the moving party. Be that as it may, what we are suggesting is here that we filed written submissions outlining what we believe the law is. We did so in good faith. We think it tracks the law. We think it will help you and guide you through this process. And we certainly are grateful for this opportunity to go even further than the written submissions. I should also note, when the written submissions were made back on the 9th of March, we were unaware of the material that we just received, although the prosecution was aware of it. However, given the instructions from the trial chamber, they were not in a position to disclose that material. And so we're not shifting any blame, or we're not complaining, but rather just mentioning that. So if our response somehow does not dovetail the facts as we know them today, it's for those reasons. So it's not that we're misrepresenting the court at the time that we made these filings. Now, the law has evolved somewhat at the ICTY. Tadic, as we know, was the very first case. And at the time, the rules did not really provide much of guidance. Later on, a rule was put in place, Rule 81-bis, or the ICTY Rules of Procedure. And this is 12 July 2007, and it states, at a request of a party or proprio motu, a judge or a chamber may order, if consistent with the interest of justice, that proceedings be conducted by way of video link conference. Then in Stanisic, it seems to have set certain criteria. Stanisic versus Simatovic, Stanisic and Simatovic, S-T-A-N-I-S-I-C, and Simanovic, S-I-M-A-T-O-V-I-C, but it's all in the written pleadings, Your Honors. And I'm referring to actually paragraph 21 of E-166/1/1. And here's what it said. One, the witness must be unable or have good reasons to be unwilling to come to the tribunal. Two, the witness's testimony must be sufficiently important to make it unfair to the requesting party to proceed without it. I'm going to focus on that a little bit as well. Three, the accused must not be prejudiced in the exercise of his or her right to confront the witness. We submit, at least those of us who come from an adversarial system and do engage in a process called cross-examination, which may not necessarily be that important in the civil law system because the judge does all the questioning and then more or less allows the parties to follow up. And the role of the defense lawyer, at least in the classical French system, is, with no disrespect to my colleagues, my understanding is to be brilliant at giving closing arguments, but at that point, it's rather late in the game, because all of the questioning is done by the judges. In the system that we have adopted here, which is a hybrid system, and we have crossed into, as I've indicated earlier this morning, into some aspects of the adversarial system, because you're allowing the prosecution to lead, to go forward with the questioning of a witness, and allowing the parties on the other side to actually ask leading questions, which is the hallmark of cross-examination. For those of us who are experiencing that in that system, in these techniques which we are using here in this court, we know that the control of the witness is terribly important. One controls the witness by being able to look at the witness square in the eye, proximity, and also it is our belief that it is terribly important for the judges to also see how the witness is behaving as being cross-examined. In the instant case, what are we being asked to do? We're asked that Dr. Kiernan, at 9 o'clock at night, after a very busy schedule of meetings, of teaching, of committee work, you've got to eat lunch at some point, maybe breakfast, maybe even dinner. I don't know his family, but I'm sure that at 9 o'clock, I know that I'm exhausted for any intellectual debate. And that's what we're asking this gentleman. So at 9 o'clock, he's going to be at every night there until midnight. And it is our respectful submission that that is not fair, not to the witness, but to us, because the witness can easily say, I am too tired, I don't wish to answer that question, and that would be it. There would be no way of coercing the witness to actually be there. And if he's that busy, he's going to be exhausted at 9 o'clock at night. And how can he possibly be cross-examined without being cross at the cross-examiners, even if they are polite to him? Because after all, we will be challenging his academic work. So we do submit that it does prejudice us, and now I'll discuss one particular case. Is this witness's testimony so sufficiently important to make it unfair to the requesting party to proceed without it? Or recall, the prosecution admits that they put him on their list. And then they mention the nunchia, but it is the prosecution that is going forward. They're the ones that drafted the introductory submission. And now they're the ones that are willing to throw in the towel without making any efforts to bring the gentleman over here. But is there no one else on earth, or no one else that we are aware of, either in Cambodia or elsewhere, that can fill the shoes of this gentleman to the limited topics of the first part of the case 002, that is 002/1. If you look at, Your Honors, the introductory submission, I invite your close scrutiny and attention. Go to footnote 1, cite 1. At the very beginning, we have Etchison. Here he's been an analyst. He's been analyzing all of these documents, albeit he doesn't speak Khmer. I think we all know that. But he's been analyzing these documents forever. He's testified before. He drafted the introductory submission. Is he not capable of covering the topics limited to this particular trial that you have identified for this particular witness, not the ones that the prosecution wishes? So are they prejudiced? And would the trial chamber be prejudiced, or anyone else be prejudiced, if another witness, doesn't have to be Edgerton, it can be someone else, comes in to discuss those issues while we wait for 2013 to have Professor Kiernan come here when his schedule allows it? What is the prejudice? As I've indicated before, you are professional judges and need not worry about the narrative coming in a particular fashion. And, let me go back to that for 1 second. Usually, in a typical case, in a common law typical case at least, judges come in not knowing a whole lot of the facts. The jury knows absolutely nothing. Here, we're in the civil law system, where the judges have read the entire file, have selected, and are selecting. And so, it's not as if somehow you're going to miss the narrative of the prosecution's case if this gentleman doesn't come in on 2012 and comes in on 2013 instead. So I think that is not really much of an argument. In fact, I would dare say it is what they call a red herring to throw you off the path. It is a deliberate technique to get you to think in other directions, that if we don't have this gentleman, then the case falls apart. In the International Criminal Tribunal for Rwanda, in one particular case, they also identified some criteria. And I'm going to spell this case because their names are terribly difficult to pronounce, and I am somewhat challenged. It's N-Z-A-B-O-N-I-M-A-N-A. And I'm referring to the case on paragraph 22 of E166/1/1. And it says, this is a quote basically, such criteria include an assessment of A, the importance of the evidence, the inability or unwillingness of the witness to travel to Arusha, and whether a good reason has been adduced for that inability and unwillingness. The party making the request bears the burden of proof to demonstrate that the conditions set out above have been met. Hearing testimony via video link is an exceptional measure. I underscore, exceptional measure. Granted only upon sound and legitimate justifications based on proper documentation. And this decision, Your Honor, was, if I'm not mistaken, in March 9, 2011. So the argument that somehow, you know, the technology has advanced so much that you don't have to worry, it's the same thing. Here you have clearly a decision from a court, a sister court, often cited by the prosecution, which sets out what it believes to be the criteria. Now, the defense in that case had requested that an expert witness testify by video link from the United States or The Hague due to security reasons. It was denied, okay, because in that they found that the allegations were extremely serious, security reasons, but it nonetheless denied the request for video link testimony, as it was not convinced that the expert witnesses' circumstances were exceptional. And because the trial chamber received no documentation supporting the claim security concerns. So this is an expert. They're talking about exceptional circumstances, and I think when we're talking about experts, Your Honors, and witnesses, there are different types of witnesses. There may be someone who comes in as a character witness, he may not be that important. There may be an expert witness who, such as Goldstone, who's going to be testifying about something that is not really much in dispute, or maybe for a particular discrete purpose, such as going to sentencing, or the gravity of the matter, or what have you. But when you're talking about an expert of Kiernan's caliber and what they expect, that's something different. Now, there's another case which I think I want to spend a couple of moments on. This is from the ICTR Appeals Chamber. And as I've noted, this is the same appeals chamber, which is the same judges at the ICTY. They just put on a different hat. Sometimes they go down to Arusha to listen to the arguments. Sometimes the arguments may be held in the Hague, but it's the same judges. Although they're looking at decisions that were taken by different courts, one in The Hague, the other in Arusha. In this case, I'll spell the name again. It's Z-I-G-I-R-A-Y-I-R-A-Z-O. And I'm referring to paragraph 27, Your Honors, of E-166/1/1. So in this case, the testimony was taken by a video link, and it was found that it had violated the fundamental due process rights at the trial level. The trial chamber moved the seat of the proceedings from Arusha to The Hague to hear the persons, to hear in person the testimony of this important prosecution witness. So in other words, the accused was in Arusha, the judges and others went to The Hague. So the accused is watching it by a video link, as would be done over here. And I will submit that it doesn't make a difference whether we're only speaking about the accused and or the lawyers who are representing the accused. The rights belong to the accused. The trial chamber moved the seat of the proceedings, as I've indicated, because of the importance of, quote, the proper assessment of an important prosecution witness. Quote, the proper assessment of an important prosecution witness. In other words, the judges wanted to properly assess the witness. They could have sat there in Arusha, and the witness could have testified from The Hague. Instead, the judges wanted to properly assess. The appeals chamber held that it was a violation of the gentleman's pronouncing his name to avoid any confusion, a violation of the gentleman's right to be tried in his presence, finding that although this right was not absolute, its restriction was unwarranted and excessive under the circumstances. And the appeals chamber excluded the testimony of the witness taken in this matter, finding that it prejudiced the gentleman's rights. So, I point this out, Your Honors. Now, of course, there are lots of different cases. Some that say you haven't provided sufficient evidence. Some that say, yes, that's enough. You'll see from our annex, we tried to guide you. If we had more time, we would have provided more. We would have provided all of the jurisprudence today. Now, I understand that we operate under different rules in the ICTY and the ICTR. And the prosecution, as well as the civil parties, go to this rule that we have here. But I suggest that even when you rule, even when you read the rule, which you cannot do so without also taking into consideration the Cambodian Constitution, the establishment law, and all the rights that are accorded to the accused, in particular those that are set out in the International Covenant on Civil and Political Rights. We submit, when you look at that, and you look at the decision, and you look at the rules that are coming out of the ICTY and the ICTR, there is little difference, if any. Obviously, you have the discretion. The prosecution will argue that it is not their wish for the gentleman to come here. He is your witness, and because he is your witness, it's up to you to demonstrate. Well, I submit that's going about it the wrong way. Because if that were the case, the prosecution could simply say, we leave it to your discretion. It's your witness. You decide whether there's sufficient evidence. Rather, they are advocating. They are advocating for the witness not to come here and appear in court. Due to the scheduling, and so that we can properly finish on time, I'm going to wrap it up, Your Honors. I don't think that I need to belabor the point. I could wax, perhaps not eloquently, but for the next hour, but I see no point to it. We submitted our written submissions. You have the law before you. You're all wise. And we leave it to your discretion. However, we must submit that it is not the same to suggest that he can testify from there. And if that is the case, if you decide, well, he's a busy professor, he's a big name, he's on this history department, and he sits on a particular chair of that department, that's rather important, he's got all these students, so let's give him a break. We would suggest, in that case, give us a break. Let us, if we so choose, to be there to cross-examine him in person. There's nothing that would prevent that from the rules. Why can't the parties not be there to confront this gentleman at 9 o'clock at night until midnight? Presumably, the testimony will take place in a court of law or someplace. Presumably, you will have UN employees over there or somebody from the court who's going to be there to monitor the situation and to assist. So there's no need, there's nothing to fear that somehow we're going to disrupt Professor Kiernan's equilibrium other than our mere presence being there. So I don't see why that could not be looked upon as an alternative. Another alternative could be that he give his prosecution evidence by video link, and in 2013 he completes the rest of his evidence here in court so we can cross-examine him. I don't have a problem with that. As long as the confrontation occurs here in Cambodia, in this courtroom, that is the best possible solution. Now you may say, well, nice try, but we're not going to give you any either one of those two. We're going to just go ahead with the video. We would submit then that at the very minimum, you have to discount his testimony because the jurisprudence is rather clear that it should have less weight. And we submit that should be the case. But from what we have seen today, and I apologize for not being able to be more diligent, although we're going to jump on this and look and see if there's anything that we need to bring to your further attention. But we submit just having a laundry list of things, or long list, easy for the translation, of items that one does, I can fill two or three pages. It doesn't mean that I cannot find 3 days in my schedule to travel someplace to testify. So with that in mind, Your Honor, I think that Kiernan has to come. He hasn't provided any compelling reasons why he cannot make it over here. But there is no reason why somebody else cannot fill his position. There's no reason why we need to rush. He's very important to the prosecution. He's going to be testifying about the entire case of 002. Such a witness cannot and should not dictate to this trial chamber if the terms and conditions of their testimony. They should appear here. He's worked here in Cambodia. He has family here in Cambodia or former family here in Cambodia. He has friends. He knows the area. It's safe. And there's no reason why he cannot come and give evidence. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Mr. President. I'll be very brief. I think most of the ground, if not all ground and arguments, were covered by the counsel for ANC very efficiently. I just want to stress that for us and for my client, Ben Kiernan is a very important witness. He's not marginal, he's very important. And we tend to rely upon his statement, a statement which hopefully he's going to give in court in our case at our closing arguments. We are disappointed by his apparent lack of enthusiasm to appear in court. I really don't understand why he doesn't seem to realize the importance of his presence here in court. And I wonder whether the prosecution has done enough to convince him of his importance, of the importance of appearing in court. In any case, I don't see why he should not be called in 2013 if he really is not available in 2012, something I'm not convinced of yet. But if he really cannot make it to Cambodia in 2012, then I'd rather have him in court in 2013 than via video link in New Hampshire next week or next month. In the alternative, the suggestion made by the defense for Ying Suri, we would like to support that as well. If he really is unable to come to Cambodia, then we take the position that somebody from the defense, from our team, should be allowed to go there to cross-examine him in the same location. That would enable him or this person to much more effectively assess his demeanor, his reactions, and eventually also his credibility as a witness. So we fully support everything that has been said by the Ying Suri defense team.
Thank you very much.
Merci, Monsieur le Président. Je ne serai pas non plus très longue. Bien sûr, du côté de la défense de Khieu
Samphan,
nous soutenons la demande que si Monsieur Ben Kiernan devait témoigner devant cette chambre, qu'il le fasse dans l'enceinte de cette audience. Je crois beaucoup à la solennité de l'audience. Je pense que c'est important lorsqu'on est un témoin et surtout lorsque l'on est un témoin expert de pouvoir être présent. Je pense que toutes les personnes dans cette salle ont des obligations professionnelles importantes. Et je pense que l'expérience au plan national montre que lorsque nous sommes convoqués devant une juridiction, encore plus devant une juridiction internationale, on peut tout à fait argumenter face à ses employeurs, face à ses collaborateurs, la nécessité de s'absenter pendant quelques jours pour venir contribuer aux travaux importants d'une juridiction internationale. C'est valable, encore une fois, devant les juridictions nationales, ça l'est d'autant plus devant votre juridiction. Et c'est vrai que je ne peux pas m'empêcher, comme mes confrères, de m'interroger sur cette apparente indisponibilité pendant toute une année d'une personne qui est présentée du côté des coprocureurs et du côté des partis civils comme un expert qui a travaillé plus de 40 ans de sa vie sur un sujet important comme celui du Cambodge et des événements qui ont marqué son histoire, et qui, alors que vous êtes quand même la juridiction exceptionnelle chargée d'examiner ces faits, ne s'arrange pas pour être un peu plus disponible. C'est vraiment une question qui se pose. Du côté des coprocureurs, on a indiqué tout à l'heure que la vidéoconférence était suffisante, que d'ailleurs dans l'affaire 001, deux experts avaient eu à être entendus de cette façon. Vous étiez dans l'affaire 001, donc je ne vais pas vous apprendre que les deux experts en question qui ont été entendus de cette manière témoignaient pour l'un, Stéphane Hessel, sur l'expérience du pardon, et pour l'autre, M. Goldstone, sur l'importance de la reconnaissance de la culpabilité par un accusé, c'est-à-dire sur des thèmes assez précis et assez limités. Le témoignage tel qu'il a été présenté par les coprocureurs et les thèmes importants qui sont annoncés ne permettent pas de mettre sur le même plan le témoignage de M. Ben Kiernan. Il va de soi, et là encore je renvoie la Chambre aux différents débats qui ont eu lieu dans cette enceinte, il va de soi qu'il y aura de nombreuses questions, à la fois sur des questions académiques, certes, mais à la fois sur des questions factuelles, puisque concrètement, il y a un certain nombre de documents dont qu'on a évoqués devant vous et pour lesquels M. Ben Kiernan aurait des explications factuelles à donner à la Chambre. Dans ces conditions, il est évident que, là je vais être extrêmement prosaïque, la question de la gestion matérielle, la communication de documents, éventuellement de passages de films, éventuellement de mettre sur écran des documents à lui faire commenter, tout ça, c'est une gestion matérielle qu'il faudra prendre en compte dans le cadre de votre décision. De la même façon, évidemment, la question du décalage horaire, là encore, je suis désolé, je parle de questions extrêmement pratiques, mais c'est vrai, ça a une incidence. Voudra dire qu'il faudra des demi-journées, que oui, même si nous sommes dans un monde moderne et qu'il y a des facilités, il y a quand même des difficultés pour avoir assisté à un certain nombre de vidéoconférences accordées pour des raisons exceptionnelles. Je sais que ce n'est pas toujours simple, et vous-même, dans le cadre du procès 001, avez eu à rencontrer ce type de difficultés lorsque ces vidéoconférences ont eu lieu. Donc, lorsque l'on met tous ces éléments bout à bout, je pense quand même qu'il serait utile d'insister auprès de M. Kiernan pour qu'il trouve le temps, et je pense que c'est une correction, vous n'êtes pas n'importe quelle juridiction, vous êtes une juridiction internationale, avec un mandat extrêmement spécifique. Je trouve qu'il est important aussi symboliquement, j'ai parlé de la solennité de l'audience, mais que ça se passe effectivement au Cambodge. Et je pense que tout témoin expert qu'il est, M. Kiernan n'en reste pas moins un témoin, et que dans la manière dont vous aurez envisagé son témoignage et à évaluer sa crédibilité ou la portée de ses déclarations, sa présence physique à l'audience est nécessaire. J'en terminerai avec un point, à savoir que si vous envisagiez cette vidéoconférence, nous demanderions également, comme les autres équipes, à ce qu'une personne de l'équipe de Khieu Samphan puisse être sur place pour garantir l'intégrité de la procédure et s'assurer que le contre-interrogatoire puisse s'effectuer dans les meilleures conditions, dans le respect le plus absolu des droits de la défense.
សូមជញ្ជឹងក្រុមមេធាវីឃាតកាលពីក្តីឲ្យលោកខឿនសំផនបាទសូមអរគុណលោកប្រធានខ្ញុំបាទសូមមានយោបល់បន្ថែមទៅលើសហភាពតារបស់ខ្ញុំតាក់ទងទៅនឹង chăm bách này vật tầm biên rộ bó xa xây chùm niên bên kia nán đài trời mập bằng hành luôn chùm bộ mục bằng xa bà nạ ca dịch nhóm dô khuyên tha vật tầm biên rộ bó lúc bên kia nán cứ miên bà giói xâm khăn á xâm rạp đâm nạ ca này tệ thí ni hai khi nhóm mơ bên khuyên tha hai đạo vấy ban chia lúc bên kia nán bà đề xét bên bộ mọc đời tòa nụ tê khiêm dô khuyên tha mô là hết đại lục ban lược đảm bay kinh vay vì cả châu luôn mọc bầm phứ nông tổ la cả đại đầm nang xã bề nhà ban bình chun nơi xiêu mong buồn chừng đi bia mình cướp quan sầm rập ao tổ la cả tổ tua scroll tha cọt mình chạm bạch máu bằng hai nơi chung phù mục sa văn cả đòi quan tại thưa cả bằng hai tại một dạng video link nu bởi đại khi ông mơ khởi này cứ càng nhiều robot quát chỉ sát ra cha mình nhẹ hay quát chỉ nhẹ bằng riêng cái lồng hạt sa robot quát anh ấy vừa chia cái ca sam manh bằng phát bạch đôi ta chia càng nhiều à chip ra trăm thay robot quát bà sân chia dương ai lơ mua là than tha con một miền nhất con là vô nông cái ca và trăm thay bạch ní hơi ăn này nhát mình bạch ai con bọc bằng lưu chủng phu mộng sam nà can để bên y tế nhưng chẳng biết tha miền xã xây chỉ trang tiết đại mình chăm bệnh mọc bằng phạ bọc bằng hai mốc chấm phu mộc sa mà nà ca rư mình chăm bệnh mọc chlai bằng phư chấm phu mộc sa mà nà ca đòi xa té bà nhà hà rù vô nông chi vật phi bạch chăm thay bỏ quạt với chân ca bằng riêng đôi khi ban đáp lư mê từ vi khẳng đa miền bắc sa tràn hai tha ai cho nó nhận chấm nộp bàn có phần té nhận đại mọc chlai bằng phư chấm phu mộc ăn sa mà nà ca nè bên nhỉ cứ mình ai cho nó nhận chấm nộp quạt bàn thì cứ quạt rơi té chơi mọc được luôn ai hai chấm nói ní trong nội tệ vị thi prom toàn bò dưỡng có anh nhát ao tơ la cá ai bằng quạ ai quạt mọc bằng phư nơi chủng phù mục ông sao nà can bán đài mà giang tiết bò dưỡng cái lấy mơ từ lơ chủng niên được bò quạt hôm nay và bọt sa hai quạt chỉ nhận sai chỉ riêng hôm nay tiệt tôn từ nâng cho bà prom toàn trả chiên nội tiết cứ tiệt tôn từ nâng lại cảm vị thi bật lại bụi xa nhưng chẳng miền này tha vì rất tại sầm khăn sầm rạp quát đại trời miền vọt tầm miền nơi tì ni vì bố tha ca mau bằng hai khuôn nơi tì ni vì chia cả tập ở cạnh rồi bỏ quát phóng hai có chia cam vật thộ nơi ca sực xa rồi xa chia rồi bỏ quát phóng đài thì tiết tôi tự đơn càng hiểu rồi bỏ quát tiết đôi chân này cả ta đã chùm rôn nhỏ quát máu ní vì chăm bạch lắng này vì miền phía trăm bạch sầm khăn lắm đó hai phần miền mua là hai đầu vây để quạt trời kích vây mình cho rùm nị tệ vị thi đại to đòi lực thai cho bộ quân tệ cha tôn từ nâng vị thiên mà phê bộ mùi rồi bỏ dưỡng để anh nhát ở miền phơi chỉ video link cứ tha nước non chụp nói trong cõi chúng bạn xem anh chún, bất chấp vật chiên ní, mình tới anh này nhát, ao prate, bờ sân bờ thưa, ao miên anh trai thun thung ố, rư mình sọp từ nương sét cà pia khluôn, và trong chấm nói ní, cứ bạn đi tha, tờ lá ca anh bạn đi sai chấm po sầm ná sầm thưa ca, chay bấm phử, tam bờ dạ video liền ní, đòi hai tha, vi miên cà pà po, đòi cà pia. Chắc chúng bạn xong lực chúng ta vậy tới đại chứa cả bác bò và cả bác bác nông cạn này đi. Nhưng khi nơi khăn nông bảo vọt rụp sẵn khép bảo quạt dọc xài chứa xa thiệt nạ tạm Internet. Nhưng ai rốt khởi. Cứ quạt xài chứa ai cả xa tiện tôn tên nâng ông bơ bà lại bụi xa này. Chẳng á, ông bánh mấy lúc mê thư vi mấy khơi khăn vã tha mình tới chiếc hà sập tì. Bọn tại khi ông bán khơi nông nông ai cả xa này tha chết mờ rồi vậy đó chết mờ rồi ăn tập bọt để quạt sạch sẽ hái quạt trời ban kia chặt tông thang chỉ nhẹ chấm niên ông pi ông bơ bảy bụi sa nơi Campuchia này tiệt cứ tiệt tôn được mai khom ăn tập bọt tập bọt quạt phía trán cứ thua sự đại sanh thán vi tầm lấy thá robot Campuchia bây giờ tập tay cứ chia robot bảy bụi sa đối chứ này cao thua sự đại sanh thán này vi thua ai bắp bò đò cá cá pia dạng khăng đã đầm rơi ơi lục bên kia nén trời tay mọi chlai bấm lư trong phu mục đòi to đầm bay ơi ơi chuôn chọp chót cái đôi mê tử vi ca pía phơ ca to tùl បាទសូមអរគុណ
អរគុណមកជាបន្តនេះសូមជាវិធីការនៃការឆ្លើយតបទៅនឹងបញ្ហាទាំងពីរដែលលើកឡើងនឹងអះអាងដោយភាគីម្ខាងទៀតហើយជំរាបសូមជំរាបថាថាប្រញ្ញាមនឹងក្រមមេធាវីតំណាងនាំមុខតំណាងដើមនឹងរដ្ឋវិនិមានពេលវេលា20នាទីហើយការបែងចែកអត្រ័យលើក្រមទាំងពីរបែងចែកពេលវេលានេះហើយអង្គជំរាបសូមផ្ដល់វិធីការទៅសហប្រញ្ញាមុនបើសិនបើសហប្រញ្ញាមានបំណងធ្វើការឆ្លើយតបទៅនឹងការលើកឡើងនឹងអាងរបស់ភាគីក្រមមេធាវីការពារក្តីសូមអញ្ជើញ
បាទសូមអរគុណលោកប្រធានខ្ញុំសូមពេលបន្តិចដើម្បីបកស្រាយឆ្លើយតបទៅនឹងអ្វីដែលលោកមេធាវីក្រមមេធាវីការពារក្តីបានលើកឡើងតាមពិតលោកបេកិនណេនគាត់មិនមានចេតនាគិតវេះដោយលោកមេធាវីបានលើកឡើងនោះទេប៉ុន្តែគាត់រវល់ការរវល់របស់គាត់គឺជាការចែកបាច់នៅក្នុងការងារប្រចាំថ្ងៃក្នុងអាជីពរបស់គាត់ជាការពិតអញ្ចឹងយើងប្រើប្រព័ន្ធសោទស្សន៍តាមការស្នើរបស់ព្រះអញ្ញាគឺជាការត្រឹមត្រូវពីព្រោះផលប្រយោជន៍គឺបែបមានទាំងអស់គ្នាសម្រាប់ភាគីហើយលោកខាងមេធាវីការពារក្តីលោកអាចចោទសួរតាមរយៈប្រព័ន្ធសោទស្សន៍បានតាមរយៈប្រព័ន្ធអេឡិចត្រូនិកបានតាមប្រព័ន្ធ LINE IT ទំនើបនេះអញ្ចឹងគឺក្នុងរយៈពេលនេះខណៈពេលនេះយើងប្រើប្រាស់លទ្ធភាពនៃពេលវេលាគឺដើម្បីផលប្រយោជន៍នៃយុតិធម៌ឲ្យបានលឿនឲ្យបានឆាប់បំផុតប្រសិនបើយើងចាំដល់ពេលដែលគាត់អាចអញ្ជើញមកបាននៅទីនេះ2013គឺមានផលប៉ះពាល់ដល់ពេលវេលាដែលយើងចង់បានលឿននីតិវិធីនៃសំណាការនៅពេលនេះអញ្ចឹងការប្រើប្រាស់ប្រព័ន្ធនេះគឺជាប្រព័ន្ធល្អដែលសព្វញ្ញាយើងឃើញថាគប្បីប្រើហើយកន្លងមកយើងបានប្រើប្រាស់ប្រព័ន្ធនេះរួចទៅហើយហើយរឿងនេះគឺមិនប៉ះពាល់ទៅដល់ភាពអន្តរាយនៃនីតិវិធីឬក៏ប៉ះពាល់ភាពអន្តរាយដទៃទៀតទេអញ្ចឹងខ្ញុំសើសុំឲ្យសាទូដល់ទទួលសូមឲ្យអង្គជំរះមេតាទទួលយកនៅសំណាក់សុំរបស់សាភិរិញ្ញាក្នុងន័យនៃការពៀនឹងបានលឿនលបឿននៃនីតិវិធីនេះឲ្យបានលឿនបានឆាប់ដើម្បីផលប្រយោជន៍នៃយុតិធម៌ធ្វើយ៉ាងម៉េចឲ្យរឿងក្តីនេះដំណើរការទៅដោយប្រកបដោយប្រសិទ្ធភាពនិងរលូនហើយគ្មានផលប៉ះពាល់អ្វីកើតឡើងទៀតទេបាទសូមអរគុណអីដោយសារពេលវេលាមានកម្រិតសូមឲ្យសាក្សីរបស់ខ្ញុំបន្ថែមទៀតនៅអ្វីដែលគាត់ចង់និយាយសូមអរគុណបាទលោកប្រធានសូមអរគុណ
Merci monsieur le président, j'essaierai d'être bref.
សូមអរគុណលោកប្រធានខ្ញុំនឹងព្យាយាមនិយាយដោយខ្លីជាដំបូងខ្ញុំក៏សង្កល់
De part adverse, l'importance du témoignage de cet expert n'est pas contestée. Il me semble que les trois équipes ont souligné qu'il était important de l'entendre. Au moins, là-dessus, nous sommes d'accord. Deuxièmement, Maître Carnavas, et je crois aussi la défense de Q Sampan, a estimé qu'il n'y aurait aucune raison valable justifiant que cet expert ne vienne pas comparaître en personne. Je voudrais juste rappeler...qu'il appartiendra à la Chambre de poser ce genre de jugement d'appréciation et non pas au parti. Les critères doivent être remplis selon la Chambre et pas selon les différents partis. Je voudrais souligner un point que je n'ai pas souligné tout à l'heure, mais Maître Carnavas, à l'instant, nous a reproché de ne pas avoir fait assez, de ne pas avoirinsister suffisamment auprès de M. Ben Kiernan de donner précisément sa disponibilité et de savoir quelles étaient ses obligations professionnelles par période. Nous avons fait ce que la Chambre nous a demandé, nous avons fait de bonne foi, de notre mieux pour satisfaire à la demande. Mais en même temps, Maître Carnavas, dans son argumentation écrite par paragraphe 14, disait aussi la défense saisit en passant cette occasion pour demander à la Chambre de première instance de rendre une ordonnance interdisant toute autre communication ex parte entre le bureau du procureur et l'expert. Nous avions reçu, dès la fin du mois de février, une copie de ces arguments écrits. Mais il nous semble quand même particulier que la défense...qualifie ces communications comme étant des communications ex parte. Qu'à la fois on nous reproche de ne pas en faire assez, d'un autre côté on nous reproche d'avoir des communications avec cet expert. Mais c'est bien ça le mandat qui nous a été confié par votre chambre, c'est d'avoir des communications avec lui afin de trouver des modalités qui pourraient permettre son témoignage devant cette chambre. Il ne s'agit pas de communication ex parte qui se ferait en secret. Il s'agit simplement de remplir un mandat qui nous a été confié. Maître Carnavas a aussi dit qu'en 2011, merci. Donc il nous a dit en 2011, on est entré avec lui en contact et il suggère l'éco-procureur, donc entrer en contact avec M. Ben Kiernan. Sinon, pourquoi figurait-il sur la liste d'éco-procureurs? Je voudrais clarifier, évidemment, que nous n'avons eu aucun contact avec le professeur Ben Kiernan en 2011 et jusqu'à ce que la Chambre nous confie cette mission de le contacter. Et je voudrais rappeler ici que la procédure est que les parties ne communiquent pas avec les témoins et les experts potentiels, même pour en dresser la liste, c'est en tout cas ce que je comprends de la procédure devant cette Chambre. Alors il a dit aussi que à 21h, le professeur serait fatigué, c'est possible. Mais il peut aussi prendre ses dispositions pour être parfaitement alerte et en forme à cette heure-là. Ce n'est pas une proposition que nous avons faite, c'est une proposition qui est venue de la part du professeur Kiernan, parce qu'il pensait que c'était la meilleure façon de procéder, étant donné ces 12 heures de décalage qui existent entre les États-Unis et le Cambodge. C'est sûr qu'il ne l'aurait pas fait l'après-midi, ce serait pire. Vous imaginez devoir témoigner entre 2 heures du matin et 6 heures du matin. Alors la défense dit aussi, à notre place, que quelqu'un pourrait très bien remplacer Ben Kiernan. Et Craig Etchison a été cité. Mais pourquoi Maître Carnavas se permet-il de penser à la place des coprocureurs? Depuis quand il est habilité à nous dire de remplacer un expert par un autre? Est-ce que nous permettons de lui dire que certains de ses témoins ne sont pas appropriés, qu'il devrait les remplacer par d'autres? Ça, à notre sens, est dépourvu de fondement et de pertinence. Je rappelle encore une fois qu'il s'agit d'un expert de la Chambre et non pas, contrairement à ce qui a encore été dit, un expert de l'accusation. Concernant l'affaire Nsa Boniman, du 9 mars 2011, je voudrais signaler que le critère du manque de volonté n'est pas un critère devant les chambres extraordinaires au Cambodge. Les critères applicables au TPIR sont profondément différents, sont plus stricts que ceux qui sont applicables devant ces chambres et qui sont reproduits à l'article, à la règle 26.1. Par exemple, la raison exceptionnelle justifiant qu'une vidéoconférence puisse être organisée n'existe pas ici. Et il y a peut-être un autre point également. Devant ces deux tribunaux ad hoc, il y a plus de possibilités pour ces tribunaux de forcer un témoin, un expert, à témoigner, à comparaître. La situation ici, est-ce qu'elle est? Elle est différente. Nous avons moins de possibilités de le faire. Enfin, concernant la solennité du tribunal, nous comprenons effectivement qu'il est plus solennel d'être ici dans une pièce avec tout le monde et que visuellement on peut voir en même temps balayer toutes les parties du regard. Mais n'oublions pas, il s'agit d'un expert, quelqu'un qui a beaucoup vécu professionnellement, qui sait exactement à qui il va s'adresser. Il n'est pas question pour lui de ne pas se rendre compte qu'en réalité il s'agit d'une audience solennelle et que il ne s'agit pas d'une conversation privée. Alors, au paragraphe 26 de la réponse de Yeng Sari, il est écrit ceci. Il y a une citation. Il arrivera souvent qu'un témoin dise en privé ce qu'il aura honte de dire en public devant un tribunal solennel. Il n'y a pas de ce genre de honte avec un expert qui sait devant qui il va témoigner. La vidéoconférence non plus ne peut pas être assimilée à une conversation privée. Voilà, j'en ai terminé, Monsieur le Président, avec mes réactions. Nous nous en tenons à ce que nous avons dit précédemment et concernant les documents aux écritures que nous avons mises au dossier.
អញ្ជើញក្រុមមេធាវីនាំមុខតំណាងដើមម្ដងរដ្ឋអវិនី
Oui, monsieur le président, mesdames, messieurs, quelques instants seulement pour vous dire que en ce qui me concerne, je pensais qu'il n'était pas nécessaire de répliquer aux arguments de la défense. Ce n'est pas parce que notre volonté est d'emboîter le pas de l'accusation. Comme ça a été dit tout à l'heure, à ce propos, je ferai juste une petite parenthèse. Je trouve qu'une telle remarque dans cette enceinte est non seulement inexacte, mais par ailleurs déplacée et désobligeante à notre égard. Je crois qu'elle n'a d'autre volonté que d'essayer de faire croire de façon publique que la partie civile n'aurait pas de place dans ce procès et pas de position particulière. Je ferme la parenthèse. En ce qui me concerne, je n'avais pas envie de répliquer aux arguments de la défense simplement parce que je n'ai pas entendu d'arguments qui nécessitaient une telle réplique. Merci.
Je vous remercie de vous donner un peu de temps à la fin de 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 la fin
Thank you, Mr. President. Let me start with the civil parties. The civil parties are associated with and usually on every single occasion adopt the prosecution's approach. Not on one single instance do I recall where they deviated from them. And so to say that they both are making the same arguments, they may be representing different interests, but they are part and parcel of the same as far as we are concerned. There's no disrespect to either the lawyers or to the civil parties, but effectively what I was trying to convey, perhaps not as eloquent as I should have, is that they adopt whatever the prosecution says. So, that's that. Let me go back with the prosecutor and his remarks. We sent a letter, I believe it was on the 9th or the 10th, and then on the 13th of March, that is of March 2012, and then on the 13th of March 2012, we sent in another letter to the senior legal officer. And in that particular letter, we noted that the prosecution had been authorized to engage in communications with Professor Kiernan. Now, that is an ex parte communication. That's how you would characterize it, because we're not a party to that communication. It's authorized. We didn't say that it was an unauthorized. We noted that it was for a specific purpose. And so we do not make any claims that somehow the prosecution acted outside its role. But in that very same letter, we indicated that for future purposes, that any communication should take place between Professor Kiernan and the trial chamber of Westshore. In the alternative, as I indicated today, as I indicated earlier, we would have preferred to have been a party, at least a representative for the defense, to the discussion between Prosecutor Cayley and Smith and Kiernan. Why? Not because of some nefarious reason that somehow they were going to talk him out of coming here. In fact, Professor Kiernan requested that the discussion be memorialized. They send him a draft, and he indicated some corrections. But as I indicated, and as I believe one of my colleagues indicated, it doesn't appear as if the prosecution pressed shall I say, impressed upon Professor Kiernan the importance of his testimony. Now, he's a busy professor, but so is Professor Chandler, his mentor. He's just as busy, yet he's able to find the time to come and give evidence to these very important issues that he's written about. And we submit that from what the prosecutor was able to get from Professor Kiernan, because they didn't really press him, tell us exactly the dates of when you are unavailable. Or tell us the events, tell us what your days are for all of these events that you described. Perhaps if we had that, I may not be making this argument. I would be making something else. But from what I have thus far, we have it because the trial chamber elected to give the prosecution the right to communicate with Kiernan. Now, we didn't suggest that they communicated actually with him in 2011, but at some point, we're talking about before the OCIJ was seized with the case, and I've indicated that, they would have talked to Kiernan. On what basis do they put him down as a witness? Normally, you would find out whether the witness is willing to testify. But in preparation of their introductory submission, they would have either directly or indirectly at some point had communications with Mr. Kiernan. Be that as it may, it's irrelevant. What's relevant for the discussions here today is that he has been put down as a witness by the prosecutor. And the prosecutor admits that it's his witness because they then say, how dare I try to substitute one of the witnesses with someone else? I'm not trying to substitute. I'm merely making the point that he is not the only human being on the planet that can give evidence on this issue. There are others who are available, they're here in country, and they're just as capable of providing the limited, or I should say the evidence limited to the confines of 002/01. And that's one of the criteria that it would be so prejudicial to the party advancing the witness that to exclude the testimony of the witness would be unfair to the party and to the proceedings. And we suggest, Your Honors, that there are alternatives. But it does beg the question. This witness, who's written so much, who's traveled Cambodia, and now in this historic occasion, he dare not come and give his evidence in court, in situ, of this very institution, and instead says, I may be available in 2013, May. But if you want me now, it has to be 9:00 to midnight, my time. And I say, Your Honor, that is an insufficient reason, and perhaps the trial chamber should consider contacting him and pressing him some more, or in the event the prosecution is asked to go back to Ms. And talk with Professor Kiernan, that one, representative from all parties be there and be allowed to ask questions, and two, that the conversation be taped recorded so that there is some sort of a record, lest there be any accusations that somehow he was pressured. That's all I have to say, Mr. President. Thank you very much. And I just want to make sure, just one finally, we are not accusing the prosecutor of doing anything unethical. But an ex parte is usually a communication between two parties where the third party is not there. Thank you.
Non, Monsieur le Président, pas d'autres commentaires.
Le លើកជាសំណូមពរតាក់ទងទៅនឹងបញ្ហានេះគឺថាយើងខ្ញុំសូមប្រកាសចំហថាសូមឲ្យលោកប៊ុនគៀនណានអញ្ជើញមកដោយផ្ទាល់នៅក្នុងសវនាការនេះដើម្បីឲ្យមេធាវីការពារអាចសួរដេញដោបានដោយសូមឲ្យក្រុមប្រឹក្សាជំនុំជម្រះមេត្តាពិនិត្យទៅលើមូលដ្ឋាននៃការដែលលោកប៊ុនគៀនណានមិនអាចមក ចូលរួមមេបានថាតើគួរឲ្យទទួលយកបានទេដោយគ្រាន់តែជាការរវល់នៅក្នុងវិជ្ជាជីវៈហើយទី2សូមក្រុមប្រឹក្សាជំនុំជម្រះមេត្តាពិនិត្យទៅលើឧបសគ្គផ្សេងៗដែលអាចកើតឡើងជាយថាហេតុនិងផលវិបាកផ្សេងៗដែលកើតឡើងតាមរយៈការធ្វើវីដេអូលីងនេះហើយទី3បញ្ហាទំនាក់ទំនងជាមួយសាកសីបែបនេះក្នុងពេលក្រោយទៀតដោយលោក មកខាងនោះបាទជំរាបជូនមិញថាឲ្យភាគីបានដឹងផងពីការរីចម្រើននៃទំនាក់ទំនងចំពោះសាក់សីនោះក៏ឲ្យភាគីមួយធ្វើការទំនាក់ទំនងទៅហើយភាគីដទៃទៀតអាចបានដឹងពីការលូតលាស់នៃទំនាក់ទំនងនោះបាទហើយម្យ៉ាងទៀតខ្ញុំសូមឆ្លើយតបទៅនឹងតំណាងសាព្រញ្ញាដែលលើកថាការធ្វើវីដេអូលីងនេះដើម្បីពន្លឿន អនីតិវិធីសវនាការនោះខ្ញុំបានយល់ឃើញថាវាអាចទទួលយកបានតែក្នុងករណីដែលវាមិនប៉ះពាល់ដល់សិទ្ធិរបស់អ្នកការពារសិទ្ធិជួនចាប់ចោតក៏ដូចជាសិទ្ធិការការពារបញ្ហានេះយើងឃើញថាបើសិនជាយើងធ្វើឲ្យតែលឿនឲ្យតែបានតែខាងលឿនតែយើងមិនបានគិតពីយុត្តិធម៌ដែលអាចកើតមានឡើង
ដោយសារប៉ះពាល់ដល់សិទ្ធិរបស់ជនជាប់ចោតជាដើមក្នុងការប្រើមិត្តប្រះមិត្តជួបបាយដើម្បីការពារតទល់ជាមួយនឹងសាក់សីដូច្នេះវាអាចធ្វើឲ្យដំណើរការនោះវាលឿនទៅដោយឥតប្រយោជន៍បាទសូមអរគុណបាទអរគុណឥឡូវនេះដល់ពេលសំលំនឹងសម្រាប់ហើយសម្រាប់កិច្ចដំណើរការសម្រាប់ថ្ងៃនេះដូច្នេះអង្គជំរះប្រកាសផ្អាកកិច្ចដំណើរការសម្រាប់ថ្ងៃនេះត្រឹមនេះសាក់សីការលើកទៅបន្តធ្វើនៅព្រឹកថ្ងៃច័ន្ទ ទី19ខែមីនាឆ្នាំ2012នៅក្នុងសប្តាហ៍ក្រោយដោយចាប់ផ្ដើមពីម៉ោង9ព្រឹកបង្កប់ឲ្យអនុរិយមន្ត្រីឃុំឃាំងប៉ុនឃុំឃាំងនាំជនជាប់ចោតទាំង3រូបទៅកាន់មន្ត្រីឃុំឃាំងនៃអបតកវិញហើយបង្កប់ឲ្យនាំខ្លួនជនជាប់ចោតទាំង3រូបមកកាន់បន្ទប់សំណាការនេះនៅព្រឹកថ្ងៃច័ន្ទទី19ខែមីនាឆ្នាំ2012ឲ្យបានមុនម៉ោង9ព្រឹកជាកំណត់សម្រាប់ចុះ